Seems I've got to have a chance to see him.
Watching the Daily Decrypt, it's currency competition time. I'm your host, Amanda B. Johnson, and today's episode is brought to you by Fort Galt. What is the price of a cryptocurrency transaction at any given time, and how can we know this? To discuss the answer to this question, I reached out to Justice Ranveer, a Bitcoin developer and reviewer at the Open Bitcoin Privacy Project, and we got to talking about more than just price discovery, let's say that. So you are Justice Ranveer, and you are, give us your bio. I mean, I know that you are a developer and a security researcher, but what is your bio at large?
Well, before I got involved with Bitcoin, I was in electrical engineering and industrial automation, and was doing that for a while, and then I heard about Bitcoin, I believe, in 2010 on Slashdot. And I paid more and more attention to it over time. And then in 2011 and 2012, that Bitcoin became almost my only hobby. And then in 2013, I quit working in the field I was in to focus entirely on Bitcoin projects. And that's what I've been doing ever since.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, you described me as a developer, but that's actually fairly recent for me.
Okay.
As in less than a year that I've actually been doing software development.
Oh, really? Okay. Wow. Well, yeah, I mean, your development that I'm familiar with, as you well know, was your writing of the wallet BIP for Bitcoin, BIP47, which I just thought was like so fucking clutch that it would just make privacy like so much better in Bitcoin. And it's like, to this day, I think, what, has anybody other than Samurai Wallet picked up on it? That's not even the topic for today's. Okay, well, good. Well, maybe we can talk about that later. Not the topic for today's episode. I just thought that was super clutch. But I knew of you before that as well because of an equally clutch thing that you published, which was prose, an article, to be precise, on the website liberty.me, where you said quite boldly, block size caps are not needed if players within the network, basically users and service providers, like miners, whatever, nodes, can simply communicate with one another in some way that makes the price of a transaction knowable at any given time. So describe for us, first of all, why is a block size cap needed in absence of price discovery? Why is there a block size cap in Bitcoin right now?
That's a complicated question. The proximate cause for why there's a block size cap is because Hal Finney thought that we needed one and convinced Satoshi to put one in. To give a more specific answer, there's really no right answer to what does Bitcoin need. Because there are different people who want Bitcoin to be different things, and in many cases, these ideas are mutually exclusive. So there are people who want Bitcoin to be peer-to-peer digital cash and want it to be a sound money system that is capable of competing with and out-competing other currencies. There's a lot of people in the world who very much do not want that outcome to happen, and so what makes Bitcoin good for them is the opposite of what makes Bitcoin good for people who want peer-to-peer digital cash. So there's whenever you're asking the question, is a particular design decision good, the answer is always yes. Every feature that Bitcoin could adopt is good, but that's asking that question is the wrong thing. You have to ask good for whom. Mm-hmm. And as in the case of a block size limit, the effect of a block size limit is it does not allow Bitcoin to be universal digital cash. It requires people to transact in Bitcoin promissory notes. And that is good for anybody who wants to prevent or reverse the monetization of Bitcoin. And it's good for the people who want to profit from via the process of money creation as fractional reserves, collecting fees on transactions between banks. A block size limit is good for them, and it's bad for everyone who's not them.
Now, let me just, our signal broke up a little bit, but I would probably ask you to repeat this, even if it hadn't. Did you just say that a block size limit is good for creating fractional reserve Bitcoin banking, essentially?
Well, yes. If you can't transact in the money directly, you have to transact in money substitutes. And this is basically the model that banking has used for hundreds of years. You know, if you go back to ancient times, people actually physically moved pieces of gold around and silver or whatever metals they were transacting in. And that's a pretty, that's a bad way of transacting. You know, there's all these disadvantages. So they moved to paper, which was a better means of exchange. But the gold and the metals stopped being money at that point, because what was the actual currency then became the promissory notes, which is a debt. Debt has the feature of it can be expanded indefinitely. So there's effectively no theoretical limits on the money supply when your currency is debt.
Okay, now describe to me how Bitcoin could be run in a way that people who held the currency or thought they held the currency were actually holding debt. How does that work?
Oh, well, we see that right now. Anybody who has a balance on an exchange is holding that exchange's debt. They're not actually holding the Bitcoins or the dollars or whatever currency. Anytime your money is actually not in your physical custody, what you hold is actually a promissory note. And it is the counterparty's promise to redeem the debt on demand. Now, they may or may not have enough of assets to actually redeem all of their notes at once. If they don't, that's called fractional reserve. And at this point, there's no way to know if all of the entities holding bitcoins on behalf of third parties actually are fully solvent. And I would be shocked if all of them are solvent. I mean, that's basically the easiest scam in any kind of system like this, is you take people's deposits and then you steal them and just keep enough around to keep the money flowing in and out so that you collect more deposits.
Mm-hmm. All right.
This is basically modern banking. There are not enough actual dollars, as in printed by the U.S. Mint, to satisfy all of the people who think they have dollars in a bank account.
All right. Well, let us then move to the reason I called you today, since we've established that fractional reserve banking with bitcoins already exists. By the way, can I ask, I'm hearing an echo of myself, but I don't know how that's possible because you're wearing headphones.
Yeah, I'm not sure. There's no speakers going here. It must be something with the Hangout.
Yeah, all right. Well, it's not too distracting. And okay, very good. So, as we've established that there already is fractional reserve banking in cryptocurrency, and Bitcoin especially, let's talk about price discovery of transaction fees. And first of all, this is all very interesting because I think that, I know that we would not be having this conversation if there were not a block size cap, because the inflation in Bitcoin right now, I would think, would be pretty much sufficient for minor profitability. Isn't it that the idea, at least, was that fees would not come about until after inflation was over? Because as a holder of Bitcoin, you're already paying fees in the form of inflation. like, already your monetary unit is being slowly, slowly debased as the currency inflates, but that could be okay with you because, hey, at least the transactions are free in the inflationary state, or am I just totally off base?
Yeah, it is true that operation of the network is paid for right now via inflation and via transaction fees. I don't think it's possible for us to know how that balance is going to play out over time. Like, we know that we have two mechanisms for paying for the network, and we know that one mechanism has decreases exponentially, and that's actually one of the biggest reasons that people invest in Bitcoin is because they know that the inflation is a temporary phenomenon. But the point at which transaction fees have to become a bigger proportion of the revenue, and who will pay those fees and how, that's not anything we can know ahead of time, because as the network grows, well, if the network is allowed to grow, if more people come into it, the incentives of the players are going to be very dynamic. Like, for example, I've just been doing thought experiments of who would pay the transaction fees in 20 years. And it could be in the present where it's end users paying transaction fees on their transactions. But it could very well, there's all kinds of other arrangements that you can imagine. Like, what if Bitcoin was the money, was the world's money? You've got these big retailers like Walmart, largest retailer in the world. They would be using Bitcoin to get paid by customers, to pay their suppliers, and to pay their employees. Maybe they would just devote a percentage of their gross to keeping the mining running, because that's what they would need to do to make sure that money still worked. Because without money, they don't have a business. So in that scenario, you could see businesses, retailers, and other companies using assurance contracts and other things to pay miners, and users not paying fees at all. But again, I have no idea if that's going to happen. That's just something that could happen. And we won't really know until that future arrives, and it will probably change as Bitcoin develops. The ways that people will pay for the network will change based on what's appropriate in that environment.
Would you say that I was in the Ethereum subreddit the other day, and a project which has not come to fruition called EtherX, like an exchange, kind of like a la BitShares, like a decentralized exchange within the single, the main Ethereum protocol, which can issue other tokens. They're basically saying, like, the fees are too high for such and such an action that's, like, kind of ruining our model. And that reminded me of a publication from another person who was building a sort of app on Ethereum called Elcoin, and he also, I believe, recently stopped development of that because he also said that the fees within Ethereum were way too high for his business model as well. And so I was like looking into, like, they keep saying like gas costs, and so I was like, okay, well, how is this gas cost established? And it turns out it's established on like the protocol level. Like, there's a minimum price of each type of transaction you could want to do that is established via the protocol level. And Ethereum miners can set a higher gas price than that if they want, but they cannot set a lower gas price than that. And so is that something that exists in Bitcoin to your knowledge, or is there no minimum on the protocol level and it's solely up to miners what fee is and isn't appropriate?
Yeah, the protocol in Bitcoin doesn't specify any minimum fees.
What do you think in terms of, because you've written before about, so anyone who tries to say set a price for various actors is basically going to fail to achieve what you call solving the economic calculation problem. And so just as a tangential question, do you believe that a minimum fee being set within the Ethereum network is basically bound to fail because it does not allow users and miners to meet on a price via supply and demand?
Well, it's definitely going to cause economic problems for them.
Already
so
is.
They've picked a set of prices relative to each other, and any time that those prices are correct, as in they are the economically optimal values, it'll only happen occasionally by accident. Because supply and demand are always changing, right? They're not fixed quantities. As technology changes, as hardware changes, so what they're trying to do is they're trying to say, well, this operation is, I don't know, 1.4 times as expensive as this operation. But that's a statement that can only ever be true instantaneously. It's never eternally true, you know, because maybe 5 years from now the computers we're using have more memory bandwidth or they're more efficient at certain instructions, so the ratios have changed. But if all that's fixed into the protocol, what will happen is when supply and demand aren't allowed to meet at their natural value, you end up with what economists call deadweight loss, which is economic value that could have been produced that wasn't produced. And, you know, systems don't actually have to be perfect. You can get away with a certain amount of it. It's kind of like how ethanol is a toxin to humans, but not everybody who consumes a little bit of alcohol dies, right? So Ethereum can have problems like this, these centrally planned prices, and the system can work, it won't work as well as it would without those. Now, if you're talking about a government-mandated currency, they don't really have to worry about those kind of problems because everyone has to use it anyway. But when you're talking about free market currencies, building in kind of economic time bombs is a problem because your competitors are not forced to implement the same time bombs, and so they can just outcompete you.
Yeah. So how could... Okay, so I was watching a talk that Andreas gave the other day, and he was basically saying, oh, this last sort of massive congestion within the Bitcoin network was due to so many people using wallets that don't correctly calculate the price of a Bitcoin transaction at any given time. But is there actually any way to know that? Or is the correct price simply just like send more than you usually would, and maybe even more than that, and if your transaction gets processed within 10 minutes, then you know that it was right. But is there actually any way to like take a survey of all existing miners, see what their price minimum is set to be, and then somehow calculate like the demand for that?
Well, I don't think there is one right price for a transaction any more than there's one right price for a car. So the price, in principle, the price of every transaction is kind of a unique thing because it depends on the preferences of the user who's making it and the resources consumed to actually get it into a block and the willingness of the nodes to relay it and the miner to include it. So yeah, prices do tend to converge to common values. We talk about the price of gasoline, even though what we see as a single price is actually just, it's made up of a whole bunch of individual prices.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a barrage of there being a single price, and the same is true of Bitcoin transactions. But if you're asking how can clients better estimate because they're trying to pay as little as possible for what they want to achieve, and the miners are trying to charge as much as possible, the same as every other service in the economy. And there are probably better techniques available for clients to negotiate better, effectively.
Like technical techniques, like something that could be written into a crypto protocol, like, and this will let a client take a brief survey of miners and choose the one that has the best price.
In principle, that's possible. I'm trying to think of what's something you buy on a regular basis?
Toilet paper.
Okay. How do you make sure that you get the right price, you're paying the right price for toilet paper?
Yeah, there is no right price, or I shop around, right? Like a price compare.
Right. So since you buy it you buy it regularly.
Yeah.
You kind of have an idea if one store is charged, like if you were to walk up and you see that the price is double what it normally is, then you could know that, and depending on how urgently you needed it and how close other stores were, you may or may not pay that.
Mm-hmm.
But you change your purchasing behavior over time, based on your experience of prices. Because, especially in the case of toilet paper, there's in the context of one single transaction, there's actually not a lot you can do. Like you show up to the store, you see the price. You either accept the price, or you either accept the price that they charge, or you accept the cost of going to a different store and with a probability that you'll get a lower price, which is not guaranteed. So this, if you were trying to simulate that in software, it would be fairly complicated, but it's something that humans just kind of do intuitively.
Right.
It's definitely a process that can happen, though. So in terms of how exactly is the best way to program that into a wallet, I don't really know.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that it is a process that happens. We do it every day. Mm-hmm. So it is possible to implement.
Mm-hmm. If the computer that is the human brain can do this, you're saying that certainly there may be some software-based solution that could also do this.
Well, and also keep in mind that a Bitcoin wallet is not just the software, it's also a software plus a human. So the software is a tool that the human's using. So, if there's a way for us to do this in our everyday life, literally every single day, then there's a way we can teach our wallet tools to do the same thing. Mm-hmm. I don't have like a, off the top of my head, this is exactly how it's going to work answer, but there's a lot of people who can work on those solutions, and again, those things will change over time. People will find better ways of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But again, there's kind of a wrong assumption in where you originally came in, that if wallets were just better at determining fees, there would be no congestion problems. And that's absolutely not true. A wallet that is better at determining a fee helps you avoid congestion only if there are wallets that are worse at it in the world, right? Because with a 1 megabyte block size limit, that is the maximum number of transactions that can happen. So let's say you improve your wallet so that it's better at optimizing fees than all of the other wallets, and so now your fees go through without problems. That's only good until all the other wallets do the same update and now you're back to where you started. But if there is a legitimate demand for 2 megabytes of transactions every 2 minutes, they're not going to fit. And no amount of fee optimization will make them fit in. And no matter how much the people are willing to pay, they still mm-hmm. won't fit.
It's like if there are 10 seats on a bus and there are 12 people who want to ride, there is no price that all of them could pay at which all of them could ride.
Exactly. And you can only get away with that kind of a supply quota if you have a government granted monopoly, effectively, because if you try to force the price up by just artificially restricting the quantity, all that will happen is that somebody will build a network that doesn't have the artificial restriction, and you'll lose everything.
Yeah, That couldn't be why I keep getting frustrated, angry emails from Bitcoin maximalists for talking about their competition, could it?
Well, yeah. I mean, the danger of a block size limit is something we've been talking about for a long time. I mean, there were people as way back as 2011 worried about this. They're saying, hey, how can we invest in this currency that has this artificial limit on it? But back then, everybody was reassured, oh, no, don't worry about it. We're going to raise the limit. There were active plans for a hard fork to raise the limit in the summer of 2012. So this, like, there are a lot of people who are new to Bitcoin who think this is a recent thing that just started, or they think it's a controversy that's been brewing over the last year, when we're in year four of this attempt to get rid of this block size limit problem. And basically, it's the same people who've been involved since the beginning. There was an anti-scaling side and a pro-scaling side, and the only thing that's really changed is that the anti-scaling side has gotten a lot of money to help them, and the pro-scaling side didn't. And so here we are.
So I want to ask your take, because every time I talk block size limit on my show, like, there's inevitably there's someone in the comment section who's like, SegWit bro, and like, Lightning Network bro. And so let us give them the benefit of the doubt that these pieces of software, like, actually do get, first of all, that they do get written, because I believe that the code for, like, this Lightning Network thing actually does not exist. I believe it's a white paper at this point. Anyway, let's give them the benefit of the doubt that these things do get written, do get implemented, and a majority of clients update, and all of that works smoothly. You're saying that these off-chain scaling solutions would still, I mean, it would basically turn Bitcoin into something perfect for fractional reserve banking. Is that what you're saying?
Well, these are two different things that you're talking about.
Yeah.
Segregated witness is a different way of it's a different way of putting transactions in the blockchain. Think of it like a different encoding method, and it effectively lets us cheat on the block size limit. And so, because it's storing transaction data outside the block itself, you can fit some more data in, and it doesn't. It's not a huge increase in capacity, but if all the transactions were using segregated witness, I think it approximately would double the transaction capability, which maybe that buys an extra year, possibly. But like, segregated witness is really it was really a solution for a problem that only Lightning Network has, which is transaction malleability and the issue of large transaction sizes. So they're kind of being sold as a package deal, even though they do different things. And Lightning Network is it's being sold as, well, this is a way of making real Bitcoin transactions. But that's not accurate. It's a way of transacting in Bitcoin substitutes. So a balance that is stored in a Lightning Network balance is not actually available to be spent on the blockchain until the channel times out or till you close out the stuff. So it really is a substitute. It's a very neat technical trick, and it probably has some uses, but it's definitely, they are not Bitcoin transactions. They're Lightning transactions, which is, you would expect there to actually be an exchange rate between Lightning balances and actual Bitcoins.
Okay, so could, say all 21 million coins had been mined, for sake of this thought experiment. If a Lightning Network were operating, and all 21 million coins had already been mined, could there be transactions on Lightning networks that were more than 21 million coins worth? Like, these money substitutes, could they be inflated beyond 21 million bitcoins?
I don't think that there's a real answer to that. A group of computers and can all agree to sign any message they want, right? So you could write software that transacts in that would sign these transactions that look like Bitcoin transactions but are not actually valid on the network and can never be settled. I mean, it is possible to write software that would do that. Would anyone do that? I can't really say. And if we're talking about a future where everybody's using Lightning and nobody's using Bitcoin except to open and close Lightning channels, then we don't really know if the Bitcoin network still exists anymore. Once you've moved to a kind of off-chain transaction system, I don't think you can make reliable predictions about how that system is going to behave. In the short term, I don't think that those kind of transactions would ever show up on Lightning. They would restrict themselves to legal Bitcoin transactions. What the future would look like in 20 years, the question is just too open-ended. But what you could have is, in the near term, what you could have is you could have these Bitcoin banks that are settling between themselves in Lightning Network. And they could have customer liabilities in excess of 21 million Bitcoins. But the maximum settlement amount that would actually settle on the chain would be limited to the amount of real Bitcoins that they held. But they could certainly have customer liabilities in excess of that.
So that you just used the term Bitcoin bank, I think is pretty, that's a pretty different term from, say, early Bitcoin marketing materials, which were be your own bank. In fact, I would say that's about as opposite as two things can be. And so you sound like you would prefer the be your own bank form of money. Is that correct?
I prefer that. I'm not opposed to Bitcoin banks existing, but I am very much opposed to Bitcoin users being forced into Bitcoin banks.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there are a lot of people who are never going to want to control their own money and be responsible for it. And so there will always be businesses that serve them. But if you create a network where you are deciding, we're going to mandate that the Bitcoin network is now a settlement layer, quote unquote, now you're saying nobody is allowed to be their own bank, whether you want to or not. And that's just a replication of the corrupt system we have today.
So then I have to ask you, do you still own any bitcoins?
I don't like to talk about my Bitcoin holdings.
I'll just tell you why I ask. So I guess I consider it, I am also like I would prefer to have the choice of whether to use a bank or to be my own bank, because I would always choose to be my own bank, because I'm one of the kinds of people who doesn't mind managing my private keys. And so, I guess I would just, this is me just trying to gauge people, like really smart people like you, trying to, because before this interview, I had sent you some materials regarding Dash, and I was wanting to know whether their forthcoming DAPI, decentralized API, could potentially be used as a tool for price discovery of processing fees. And you had mentioned that you weren't familiar with that, and so I guess I'm just trying to gauge, like, is that because you aren't interested in exploring, like, Bitcoin competitors?
Well, I will say I do not hold any cryptocurrencies other than Bitcoin. In the last year, my allocation of assets has changed. My allocation of liquidity has changed, but it hasn't been into other cryptocurrencies.
I guess I'm just trying to understand, like, so someone who's like, whoa, I don't like the direction that Bitcoin is going, why would you sell back to fiat before trying something else that might actually have, like, a better solution?
So over the years, like, it's thinking about Bitcoin has been a really challenging thing, right? Because we went through 2013 where Bitcoin went from like $10 to $200, and you know, there are times where we were like doubling every price every few days, and so keeping track, just keeping using Bitcoin has been challenging as a unit of account to keep track of over the years. So the way I started, back in 2013, the way I started measuring my savings was in months of living expenses. And so that turned out to be a little bit easier to keep a grasp on. So, and I would allocate how many months of living expenses do I want in dollars versus how much am I willing to have all in bitcoins. And that's kind of like a safety margin, right? Because, you know, if there's a price dip, then suddenly you might need to use more of those dollars. So as my as the amount of expenses that I can pay has been payable in Bitcoin, that's kind of affected my ratio of the expenses in dollars versus months in Bitcoin. And so what I would say right now is that I have more dollar runway now than I would have, say, 2 years ago, just because of the, you know, changes in the, my own expenses and the uncertainties in Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So if I'm going to hedge, you know, in some currency, I would hedge in the currency that I actually need to spend on my routine expenses. If I were ever to switch to another cryptocurrency, I would move everything all at once.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll watch the blockchain for a whale move, and I'll wonder if it was you. In a closing question, can I ask, do you have any sort of thoughts about, I don't know if you saw, I made a video about potential risks of the halving in terms of there being a network capacity limit last week, and I was wondering if you have any sort of thoughts about, are there risks of a halving with a network capacity limit, or what do you sort of think might happen in July?
Well, if a large fraction of the hash rate goes away while the network is operating near the transaction rate capacity, that would be a huge problem, for sure. I guess I would say I'm not all that worried about a massive loss of hashing power at this summer, especially because there are new ASICs coming online. There's new generations, smaller feature size, and I would expect that those things should roughly cancel each other out, especially because the miners have known this halving was coming. So I wouldn't expect a 50% drop in the hash rate this summer. I mean, I would be surprised if that happened, is what I'm saying.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for your time, Justice. And you mind giving us like a website or two where people can follow what it is that you do? I may have neglected to mention that Justice is a reviewer for the Open Bitcoin Privacy Project, the Wallet Rating Project.
Yeah, that's probably the best website to mention right now. I haven't been doing a lot of writing recently. But yeah, we released our second privacy report recently, and we're gearing up for the third one. So definitely check out the OBPP website.
OBPP, and is it .com?
It's openbitcoinprivacyproject.org.
openbitcoinprivacyproject.org. That's easier to remember. Okay, very good. Well, thank you for your time, Justice.
Thank you.
Today's episode is brought to you by Fort Galt, which is an early-stage community for entrepreneurs and their families located on the coast of Chile near Valdivia. Fort Galt's 100 acres are pre-installed with water and power lines, and Bitcoin is accepted for purchase of property or reservation of apartments. You can find out current availability and prices by visiting fortgalt.com. Well, that does it for today, dear viewer. Thank you for your time and watching, and thanks, as always, to those who send the Daily Decrypt micro tips. That is quite kind of you, and we notice and appreciate them, and it's great. Have a good day. What we have here is a network in which users cannot be sure whether developers work for them or for someone else. And this is understandable because, after all, Bitcoin users don't pay their developers, and never have. And if users don't pay developers, someone else will.